Ladies and gentlemen, my name is TotalBiscuit. Well, I did promise a little bit of footage from the trip I had to Frogster Studios to have a look at TERA online, so that's exactly what I'm going to try and provide you at the moment. We'll be looking to put together two videos on this one. We've got some Slayer gameplay, and we've got some Sorcerer gameplay. All with Popori, I might add. Very important. These crazy-ass beaver squirrel-type things over to the right. That is huge, the Popori Slayer, as you can very clearly see. Two-handed warrior-style class, and the Sorcerer, which I'll show you in a future video, is, needless to say, a spellcaster. Before I go on, I've got to apologize for the lack of sound. You won't realize it now because I've overlaid some of the pieces of the forthcoming Western version of the TERA Online soundtrack. Sadly, there's only about four pieces of that currently out in the open, so it's a bit difficult. You'll probably hear it looping over and over, but for some reason, the machine we recorded on refused to capture the sound. I have no idea why that is, so sadly, there is no in-game sound in any of this footage. Kinda sucks. My apologies for that. Hopefully, once I get access to TERA on my machine, as opposed to in that studio, which should be quite soon, I can have a more in-depth look and actually bring you some of the proper sound. Whatever the case, this is to demonstrate a few different things, including combat mechanics, and just give you a bit of a look at the world. Now, the stuff you're going to be seeing here is more in advance of what you'll have available to you in the sneak peeks, but what you're going to be seeing in the sneak peek is level 22 stuff. This character is level 38, so it's a little bit higher level, and what I'm going to do is show you some of the open world stuff and a little bit of the kind of open dungeon style areas, which are primarily questing hubs that are accessible to everyone. They are non-instanced. Alright, so let's hop into the game, and here we go. Huge, the level 38 Popori Slayer, as you can very clearly see there. You'll notice that my party is not around here. I have to actually switch channel. Some of you are probably aware of this mechanic if you played anything like DDO, for instance. It's a set of instanced areas. If there's too many people in one area, then you can hop over into another where it's less crowded. As to whether or not this will be in the final version of the game, that remains to be seen. This was being used as part of the internal testing version that I've got right here. Here are my friends, as you can see. A wide variety of complete nonsense. We've got the classy dog there, also the berserking rabbit, all sorts of nonsense there. It's a rather interesting racial choice. In fact, it's kind of the only race that I think I can really tolerate in this particular game, because the game is very Asian looking. They didn't make a huge amount of changes to the art style at all, and to some degree it's quite endearing. I think the Popori look kick-ass and bizarre and weird, but the rest of it, it's kind of the standard sort of anime chibi stuff with some of the Asian style of elves that don't really wear a lot of clothing and have a lot of spiky stuff on what they are wearing, and so on and so forth. I think you get the idea. You've probably seen the graphic style of this before. It is a very good looking game. There's no real question about that. It should be. It's done in the Unreal Engine 3, so it is rather significant in terms of a graphical advancement over the current generation of stuff we've got. It's better looking than the Old Republic, there's no real doubt about that. It's much better looking than WoW, and one might argue that it's better looking than Guild Wars 2, but I think that's going to come down to aesthetic choice, really, and one of them looks very Western and the other looks somewhat Eastern. They're both equally good looking games, so I imagine there'll be plenty of fanboys arguing over that, but it doesn't really matter because it's a good-looking game. Right, you'll see some combat animations right there, and the first thing to note, and this is kind of a refresher, I suppose, from the video of the low-level stuff that I was able to show you from Gamescom, is that the combat system is very much action-based in this game. And by action-based, I mean you are not relying entirely on hotkeys for everything. A lot of the attacks are actually controlled via the use of the mouse, and all attacks have to be manually aimed, with the exception of lock-based attacks, and there aren't very many of those. As far as I can tell, the Slayer doesn't seem to have one. It might somewhere deep in its skill tree, but all of the abilities that I used as the Slayer involve hacking and slashing away and actually manually aiming, which is quite interesting. Like, for instance, the charge style ability, which allows you to leap into combat, you had to aim that, and if it missed, then, well, you don't end up doing an awful lot of damage to anyone, do you? So it's a little bit useless. Before we go on, of course, the most important feature of the game. Does it have dances? Yes, it does. The Popori dance is rather amusing, I have to say, but there you go. Okay, I've shown you that. So what I want to show you really is the combat, because I think this is what we should be focusing on if we're looking at TERA Online. I can just flat out say, from what I've seen in the content that I'm going to show you here and in the 2-hour play session that I had over at Frogster, that the questing is very much a traditional Western style of MMO. You pick your quest up, you might see it on the mini-map, usually you can, so you can spot where things are. You go and hand it in, and then that's kind of it. And a lot of these are drop-based quests or kill X of this, so there isn't a huge amount of change in that particular style there. The change is in the nature of the combat as opposed to the actual questing mechanics. All right, we're going to have a quick look at some of the basic abilities of the Slayer, and this would be, I would imagine, rather interesting for those of you wanting to play something like that. So you can see the learned skills there that you can drag into the bar, and the bar's quite small, and that's deliberate. That's the overhand strike right there, which is a big downward strike. Once again, you have to aim this, and if it misses, then it's not going to do any damage whatsoever. It activates faster if you use certain abilities beforehand, and that's quite important. I'll tell you about that in a minute. Stunning backhand, that's a brief stun, of course. Distant blade right there, you can actually magically extend your sword, and you can even repeat the attack, which is quite cool. Fury strike, slash your sword in front of you, and actually lowers your HP. And this is the combo attack system. You might wonder what that's all about. The combo attack is just what you do when you continually click the left mouse button over and over again, and that's going to build up in damage. And then my right click there is bound to Whirlwind, and the C button is bound to one of my evasion abilities, Evasive Roll. And dodging is pretty important in this game, and you're going to find that out as we go into some of this combat, certainly the higher level stuff. Right now we're going to be fighting stuff which is a little bit lower level, so I wouldn't expect to see me taking an awful lot of damage, but in my sorcerer footage you're going to notice the dodge mechanics come into play there, because the creatures we're fighting are of our level or otherwise higher. You'll notice there's some motes dropped on the ground. This is a fairly interesting way of support. A lot of the support abilities seem to revolve around dropping things on the ground for others to pick up. In this case, that is a health mote, as you would imagine, so you click that to get an instant boost of health, no problem at all. Now, I wanted to tell you a little bit about the combo system, because this is interesting to say the least, and it actually solves a number of issues that I've got going on with the combat system of MMOs in general, and the way that these skills are actually controlled. So let's go into a little bit of combat to show you what's going on with this, and I'll explain how the system actually works. Alright, this turtle is my mortal enemy and must be destroyed. Now, I need you to look out for something on the screen. There you go. You might have noticed something right there, the overhand strike, that popped up on the screen. You might think, well, what the hell is that? Why does it say spacebar? So, this is part of the combo system. What you can do is you can set up a number of custom combos which lead one ability into the next. It's kind of like a casting rotation in other more traditional hotkey-based MMOs. In this case, however, there's actually a degree of timing to it, and this is designed so that you don't have to have about 30 or 40 skills on your hotbar in any given time. You can actually set things up so that a combo will trigger after certain abilities. You'll see the startling kick right there is available in my combo or an overhand strike. Now at this stage I'm not actually using the combo system because the developers haven't explained what it means yet, and I believe I ask them momentarily what the hell is going on with that. But there's a timing element to this. So this is not simply a case of, hey, it will allow you to use a number of different abilities by simply pressing the space bar. You only have a short period of time to hit that button. And if you do hit the button, which is bound by default to space bar, then the ability will trigger faster. So it encourages you to make use of the combo system in a way that makes sense. Now, the reason that I particularly like this is because it allows you to free up your bars, means that the UI is far less cluttered, and it also means that you don't need a ridiculous number of key bindings in order to properly and efficiently fight. For instance, in World of Warcraft, you might be remembering that you were using a certain number of buttons, and maybe you, it depends on the size of your hands really, you'd be able to comfortably reach certain buttons. I mean, I can comfortably reach about to 1 to 8, really. And while I'm using WASD, so if I can't reach any further than that, then I'm not really going to be able to use those buttons there. And then, of course, you've got shift modifiers, control modifiers, and alt modifiers, and it can get a little bit of a pain in the ass, honestly. It's easy enough to learn once you've had a lot of practice, but it's still awkward, and it's very, very easy to end up hitting the wrong button. In this case, what you've got is a set of about 6 or 7 abilities down at the bottom, and then the abilities which are generally used at specific times would pop up on the screen as part of the combo. So I can then go into a overhand strike and so on and so forth from there. That will make my ability faster. At the moment, I'm just kind of hacking and slashing my way through all of these guys using whirlwinds and trying out all of my different abilities. So I'm going to skip forward a little bit to show you the combo system actually being used and the amount of damage that you can do if you properly pull this off. Alright, let's just have a look at that, shall we? This is a little bit further on in our video. Alright, so we're inside a level 30-ish open dungeon called the Pirate's Grotto, which is a very large quest hub here. And what you're going to see right there is the use of my overhand smash combo. And you'll have also noticed a big red splat on the screen, this big critical massive damage hit that I was able to inflict as a direct result of that. And you can do that pretty much whenever the abilities are actually off cooldown without too much of a problem. And it's quite context sensitive. For instance, instead of having a button bound to the retaliate ability, you probably know what retaliate is. It's the same as revenge in World of Warcraft. You get hit under specific circumstances and you can then actually end up retaliating. My God, I just love the way that he jumps across the screen there and sticks his sword in the ground. Yes. Aiming does help. My Popori is a little bit blind. So that will pop up on the screen as a space bar out there, and if you pull that off in the appropriate time, then you will get a bonus in that respect to the speed of the attack. It'll sometimes display some kind of interesting stuff, like Startling Kick, for instance, is a cool ability to try and get a monster off you or to just slightly get into a better position because, of course, it does have a stun mechanic attached to it. More to the point, that will also actually make you hop backwards, so you can get out of the way with that. And there are a number of abilities that have evasion mechanics. The evasive roll that I've got on C right there is a pure evasion mechanic, but there are some abilities that have one kind of attached in there to make sure you don't get too far into the combat if you're not too careful. Wow. Yeah, 5,000 damage on that one. So that was a pretty good use of the overhand strike as far as I'm concerned. Some interesting design choices on the various enemies here. They look pretty damn awesome, I've got to say. So I certainly approve of that. But the combat is very dynamic, it's very kinetic, it is highly action-orientated, and it does have an element of skill as well. Needless to say, if you're using a ranged class, then aiming will be required. You will see that in the Sorcerer video that I put out, but the archer's going to have to aim. There is no auto-aim or anything along those lines, which in itself is quite good because you've got enemies that are moving around quite a bit, so you're having to kind of pay attention. I suppose a lot of you have experienced, if you've played WoW, the whole autopilot kind of idea, that you simply end up going on autopilot and not really paying attention to what's actually happening. And one can hardly blame you for that, because the only time you really need to change what you're doing is if an ability goes off that forces you to move. In this case, you are constantly having to aim your attacks, and certain attacks work in different ways. This auto-locking doesn't really happen as regards to your abilities. There are certain abilities called lock abilities. There's a heal, for instance, that does that, but the vast majority of abilities don't, and you're going to have to be aiming manually there, which is in itself pretty neat. Now, this is an interesting mechanic right there that I didn't know about, and this is a big fire. You can have a fire pretty much anywhere, and this will allow you to actually raise your maximum health for a time. So you can see the heart up there, and once it gets to 120%, that'll be maxed out. Now, if I recall correctly, there are also things that you can toss into the fire, and they will grant a variety of different buffs. So that's an interesting little mechanic there, and you can set up fires wherever you want, so you don't really need to go to one of these areas here, but you'll see that that's now maxed out on 120% with your normal, everyday, run-of-the-mill fire. Well, I think you can figure out what those exclamation marks are. That is indeed the questing system. Very similar to traditional MMOs. I don't think anyone's really surprised by that as far as I am concerned. And you can just select your quest and go right ahead with it. The minimap offers a great degree of tracking for a lot of these quests, as well as showing the location of enemies and things like that. So you shouldn't have too much of a problem finding where you're supposed to be going here. Now, when it comes down to quests like this, I require one of two things. Either I require significant context, which makes me feel that the quest is meaningful, which is something that the Old Republic does quite well. because of the amount of voice acting and the script writing that's going on there. Or I require a sufficiently enjoyable combat system so that this doesn't feel like grind. In this case, I would say that TERA has nailed the second one down very well. As regards to context and voice acting, not really so much. I mean, it's quest text. As the developers were saying right there, who the hell ever reads the quest text? And they're right, of course. There's no real question about that. But the combat system does allow for some far more enjoyable experiences. And as you're going to see a little bit later on in the Sorcerer video, where we actually fight against stuff of equal level, it's not easy. You will actually get your ass kicked if you are not careful. You have to very carefully use your abilities. You can't just sit there and eat damage. You will die too quickly. It's as simple as that. Even a character like Slayer, who is, as you would imagine, a little bit beefy, can take quite a bit of damage and end up going down before you know what's happening. So it's a little bit intimidating. It's good, though. I think that if the combat system and indeed the balance of the game was in such a state that you could simply hack and slash your way through everything and not have to worry about what moves you used and taking damage, then the game has failed. It's as simple as that. It has got to be of a sufficiently challenging level to ensure that the combat system kind of comes into its own and provides you with an interesting gameplay experience. I feel that if TERA Online doesn't manage to do that, then the leveling process will be laborious, and as a result, I probably won't end up getting to max level in this game. I do, of course, intend to play it, as I intend to play a lot of different MMOs. I like to try them every now and again. Some I don't play for all that long. But if the actual leveling experience isn't challenging enough, and if the combat system isn't really used, it seems wasteful, really, doesn't it? If you've got a really nice, elegant, action-orientated, skill-based combat system, and yet the game and its leveling up process is so easy that it doesn't matter which ability you use. You can just keep clicking the left mouse button over and over again, and maybe click the right mouse button for an AoE, and that's all you need to do. That would disappoint me if that were the case. From what I saw in the later level stuff in the Sorcerer video, where I was able to actually die, then I think that that might not end up being a problem. But of course, feel free to check out the game over the sneak peek period and see whether or not it's actually up to snuff in that regard. I'd imagine the lower level stuff will, of course, be easier, but I would hope that the mid to high level does start to really ramp things up and make you think about the moves you're actually using. Alright, we're just going to skip forward once again just to show off a little more combat here. Hopefully this has been relatively informative and gives you a feeling of what TERA seems to offer. There are things like instances available, of course, there's a full guild functionality and all that good stuff. The interesting thing that I would like to point out about the combat system is that it's action-orientated and to the point where they say that it is actually playable with a controller if you so desire. Personally, I would not play an MMO with a controller, but I can see with the combo system that it would actually be a viable thing to do, and the combat does feel fairly hack and slashy in a good way, I've got to say. It's very much something that would work with a pad, I suppose, but that's not something that I personally would do, as you might imagine. I'm going to smack my way through this boss monster right here, as you can see, and deal a ton of damage in the process. I do like the fact that there are a lot of enemies on the screen at any given time as well. You're generally not fighting two or three. You're probably fighting about 20 to 30, because every swing of your weapon has collision detection. It will hit things that are nearby, which is something that a lot of games haven't done or have done to a very basic degree, like DC Universe Online. It had this weird setup whereby you'd do very, very small amounts of peripheral damage to things that were in your arc of swing, but you'd only do your full damage to one target. I didn't really like that all that much. And this game just goes all the way and says, you know what, you've got a big sword and you swing it through multiple opponents, it's going to do a lot of damage. It's very hack and slashy. And as a result, it's very satisfying. And you've got a lot of knockbacks and things like that. You can knock creatures firmly in the air, knock them to the ground and do extra damage, as you can see right there. It is a meaty combat system. Something that I'd hope to see coming from MMOs, and we're only just starting to see that. Games like Vindictus kind of kicked it off, and games like DC Universe Online sort of got it, but TERA feels like the first real MMO that's got the action combat system really down. And while hotkeys are of course used, the combat system means that it's more of a fluid experience, and it does feel like you're actually attacking, and of course with the lack of auto-aim and having to aim all of your attacks and these big swings that have collision detection, it feels like an action game in that respect, with MMO elements in there as well. And it doesn't seem to really sacrifice either of those elements in order to achieve its goal, from what I've seen up to this point anyway. I'll try and bring you some more on this. I'm going to show you some Sorcerer gameplay in the next video, and then of course once I have full access to this game, I'll be able to investigate things like instances more readily. My name's been TotalBiscuit, taking a look at TERA Online. This footage was taken in the Frogster Studios over in Berlin, and I will see you next time.